In this video, we'll find out the problems with the typical software development and deployment process, what is continuous integration, and how continuous integration can help resolve those problems. Now, if you've watched my last video in full where I showed a typical software development and deployment process, you might remember that near the end of the video, I mentioned that there are many problems with the way Easy Software develops and deploys its software. Let's quickly recap Easy Software's development and deployment process to understand the problems a little better. Easy Software, as we discussed in the last video, has three software development teams, each working on writing different code as a specific software module. These modules, which are nothing but pieces of independent software written in the human readable language, are then checked into separate folders or repositories on the source control system. This checking in the code to the source control system is also called committing the code. The three teams may check in or commit the code to the folders in the source control system multiple times during the sprint. Then, at the end of the sprint, the integration team collects the code from these different repositories, merges the code, and then stores the merged code in a separate folder, also called the mainline repository, on the same source control system. The integration team then builds or compiles the code on an available computer that the integration team owns, and then sends the compiled code along with the deployment or installation instructions to the operations team. The operations team takes this compiled code and follows the included instructions to install it to various environments like test environment, staging environment, and finally to the production environment that is accessible to the end user. Let's zoom into the integration piece of the entire software development and deployment process, which is this. Here are a few things that stand out immediately. Integrating the code from different teams with developers who might have different coding styles can be a daunting task, especially when doing it all at once in huge chunks at the end of the sprint. This may lead to merge conflicts and failed builds, requiring the developers from different teams to rework, even when they have already moved on to working on the next piece of software in the following sprint. I'm assuming that there are no gaps between the sprints. There shouldn't be any gaps. If you look carefully, this process will not only cause a lot of confusion among developers who will be required to go back to those pieces of the code that they wrote in the last sprint, but will also take multiple days for the merging to complete, involving the effort from the developers of the three teams and members of the integration team, all trying to figure out how to fit different pieces of the code together. Let's imagine that all the merge conflicts are resolved and the development team fixed all the bugs. It's now time for the integration team to rebuild or recompile the code. Since this recompilation happens on an available personal computer owned by the integration team members, the final compiled code often gets contaminated by the automatic operating system updates and personal preferences. This often results in releases that are unstable and error-prone when transferred to the production environment. For a release to be stable, the integration environment must be identical to the final production environment. On top of this, the integration team can only deliver the final compiled code to the operations team only once every sprint. This, as you might imagine, causes lots of delays and often results in the code not being deployed to production until it is fixed in a subsequent sprint. Let's summarize. With the current integration process, we have, number one, a high chance of rework and bugs. Number two, by the time bugs are fixed, it's often too late. Number three, fixing the bugs and resolving the merge conflicts requires a lot of effort. Number four, it is not easy to reproduce the compiled code with the same configuration as the production environment. And number five, since release happens only once per sprint, it causes delays. All right, now that we have a clear understanding of what's wrong with the current integration process, let's see how the concept of continuous integration can help. But first, what is continuous integration? Continuous integration is a development practice that requires developers, not a separate team that does the integration. It requires the developers to integrate units of code into a single shared repository on the source control system multiple times a day. The absence of a separate dedicated integration team requires the developers to integrate the code themselves, meaning that each team and each developer has to do a bit extra work to make sure that the code works with the rest of the code, which makes sense since the developers are the ones who created the code. They know the code better than the members of the integration team and hence must know how it should fit with the rest of the code and what exactly could go wrong, reducing the time to fix the code in case something does go wrong. As soon as the code is successfully merged, the continuous integration server automatically triggers the build, on a dedicated build server. Now, since this is a dedicated build server and not a personal computer of a member of the integration team, it's easy to maintain its configuration in a way that resembles the configuration of the production environment. All developers in all the three teams now have access to the results of the build. This makes it easy for the developers to see if the code is compiled or if there is a problem that they need to resolve. A successful build then triggers the automated test on a different automated test environment to ensure that we get the best release possible. The whole build process, compilation, and automated tests should be quick so that the results of the code check-in can be communicated to the developers as soon as possible, who can then fix whatever needs fixing on a timely basis, ensuring that the code base stays healthy and everybody can continue working. This is what a typical continuous integration process looks like. Pretty straightforward. Although the continuous integration process may look different for different teams, all teams must adhere to a few principles to implement continuous integration successfully in their overall development process. Principle number one, maintaining one shared central code repository. Continuous integration requires all code from different teams to work together correctly. For this reason, branching, also called temporarily storing code from different developers in different teams into separate repositories on the source control system, should be kept to a minimum, and all the code should be merged into the mainline repository as soon as possible. This leads us to principle number two. Developers should commit their code to the mainline repository frequently. The longer a developer holds onto the code without building and testing it, the more likely it is to be inconsistent with other changes that have been made in the central mainline repository. Principle number three, maintaining separate build and test servers. Fast builds catch errors before it's too late. To speed up the builds, a different machine should be designated for build purposes so that it does not impact the development pace of other developers. Developers must also be notified as soon as possible if there is an issue with their specific integration. Principle number four, builds and tests must be automated. Every commit of the code, or in simple words, every check-in of the code into the source control system should be built and tested automatically. Continuous integration tools like Jenkins, Bamboo, GitLab, etc. can help in constantly checking the mainline repository for changes. When a change is detected, these tools perform a build and later test the build code. Principle number five, use production-like testing environments. The testing environment should be as similar as possible to the eventual production environment, with configuration as similar as will be encountered in the production environment. This ensures the usefulness of the test and keeps the expectations consistent throughout the deployment. Principle number six, QA should have access to the builds. Along with the developers, QA must have constant access to the builds, so that any failure to meet product requirements can be found as soon as possible. Early detection will lessen the danger of having to rework everything later. Okay, now that we know what should be done to get to continuous integration, let's look at the benefits of having a continuous integration setup. Here's how the EasySoft continuous integration setup looks like. The three EasySoft teams check in or commit their code multiple times every day to a central source code repository, also called the mainline repository. This code then gets compiled and passed through specific tests. Tests like unit tests, automated UI tests, security tests, and anything else that can be automated. This simple process results in numerous benefits. For example, the integration process takes less time and effort. Every developer now integrates their own code into a central mainline repository instead of a dedicated integration team that merges the code from different repositories. Number two, automating builds as soon as new code is checked in results in a code that is always compiled and tested. Before continuous integration, this happened only once every sprint. Now, it can happen many times a day. This surfaces issues early on, making them easier to be fixed. Also, since the build and test processes are automated, there are fewer chances for humans to make mistakes, resulting in a process that is less prone to errors. Next, increased visibility allows everyone to see what has been checked in and what are the results of the latest builds, making it possible for the developers to get timely feedback, confirming if everything fits together or not. Next, continuous integration also results in better overall team communication. By having improved communication, the chances that everything fits together well becomes higher, resulting in better software. Finally, because of the short feedback loops, the teams can make changes more often, allowing them to react to customers' needs better. Also, more importantly, the code can now be delivered to operations more often, resulting in more releases. This means a shorter time to market and a higher ability to react to customers' needs. So there you have it. Now that we have a good understanding of what continuous integration is, in the following video, we will take a look at the second piece of the CI/CD puzzle, continuous delivery. If you got any value out of this video, then do not forget to smash that like button, subscribe, and leave your valuable comments. I'll see you in the next video.